Hello, my name is Pastor Kyle Caldell from Union Baptist Church in Iowa, South Carolina. I want to thank you personally for joining us for this sermon today. I'm extraordinarily blessed and honored that you would choose to watch us. Now, if you'd like, you can go on to unionbaptistiowa.com and you can find more information about who we are as a church, what we do, even more sermons and resources there. Would you take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of 1 Peter this morning? 1 Peter chapter number 4. Now, one of the great things about the internet, being online streaming services, is that we have a big variety in audience. The problem is we don't know everybody that watches it personally. I wish that I did, but I simply don't. But I've lived long enough to know this. Though I may not know you personally, I may not know your struggles, I may not know what you're dealing with and going through right now, I do know that there are many people who are watching this sermon today who are really going through some hard times. I know that. I know that there are many people who are watching this sermon today that you would say, Pastor, I'm at the end of my rope. I'm bumping my head on the ceiling. I've been waiting for that light at the end of the tunnel for some time now, and it's still mighty dark. My prayer for you today is that against all the odds, you would see a God who is bigger than the circumstances that you face, that you would see a King who is mightier than the battle in which you're engaged. You would see a Lord and Savior who is sovereign over all. And I believe with all of my heart that you can see the bridge that spans the gap between heartbreak and hallelujah. Would you look with me at 1 Peter chapter number 4, beginning in verse 12. The Bible says, Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing is happening unto you. But rejoice inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, you may be glad with exceeding joy. If you reproach for the name of Christ, happy are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rest upon you. On their part, he is evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. For the time has come that judgment must begin in the house of God, and if it first begin at us, what shall the end of them be that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing, as unto a faithful creator. Lord, this is your word, not ours. We don't have the authority to manipulate it, to twist it, to bend it, to suit our traditions, our opinions, or even our sermons. We simply are to preach it as it is, hear it as it is, and respond to it as it is. Father, I pray that you'd put your thoughts in my mind, your words in my mouth. Lord, we confess together that Satan is a defeated foe, that Jesus Christ is Lord, and ask that his will is done on earth as it is in heaven. We give you praise, honor, and glory for these things and more. And we ask them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to share with you from our text how to span that gap between heartbreak and hallelujah. There are just a few things that I want to share with you this morning, but I think they're incredibly important, specifically if you are that one who is really in a season of struggle. The first thing is this: if I'm going to move from heartbreak to hallelujah, I must understand that life is an ongoing battle. Life is an ongoing battle. Peter says this in verse 12. Peter tells us who he's talking to. Peter says, Beloved, beloved, those who are loved by God, dear friends. This is extraordinarily important. Notice who Peter is addressing. It's not just anybody. Peter is speaking specifically to Christians, those who belong to God. And notice what he says, Beloved, those who belong to God, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing is happening. Catch this. Peter is saying hard times are going to come. It shouldn't be weird when they do. It shouldn't be an odd thing. It shouldn't be strange when difficulty comes into your life. Times get difficult for those who are in Christ. Peter is writing to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's reminding us that life is an ongoing battle. Now, there are two major problems that people have with that thought. And both of them are due to poor teaching, to be quite honest with you. The first is this: they would respond when hard times come by saying, "Hey, wait a minute, I'm a Christian. This shouldn't be happening to me." That comes again from false teaching, from faulty theology, the idea that Christians don't have battles. Listen, trouble in this world is a result of the fall. Nothing works as it should. Because of that, there's going to be pain, and there's going to be heartbreak, and there's going to be failure and rejection and grief and death. These things are reality. And they're not only a reality for those outside of the church, they're reality for those who are inside the church as well. For both Christians and non-Christians, you could be a believer and you're still going to get stuck in traffic from time to time. You can be a believer and you're still going to battle with mole crickets and dollar spot and army worms and crabgrass in your yard. You can be a Christian and you still have the washing machine go out. You can be in Christ, passionate follower of Jesus Christ. And guess what? You're still going to get hung up in the Walmart line. It's going to take place. Being washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ doesn't build some force field of immunity around us from hardship. Peter is saying to those who are in Christ, hey, life is going to be a battle. Don't be shocked by it. Now, again, some would say to that, wait a minute, that's not right. That's not fair. I thought God loved me. I'm a Christian. If God loved me, he would never allow this to happen. If that's you, I want you to notice what Peter calls the trouble that we face. He says, beloved, you're going to face some fiery ordeals. Underline that. That's kind of a big deal. That word is used elsewhere in the New Testament. You see it written this way, a refiner's fire. The refiner's fire is the blistering heat that a metal worker would use to make metal pliable, to remove any impurity from it. It was extraordinarily purposeful. We say here at Union often that God is sovereign, that he's in control. Spurgeon said the sovereignty of God, that idea was the pillow upon which he rested his head at night. And so should you. Christian, you should never reason that a difficulty that's come into your life, a suffering, a season of suffering that's come into your life, even persecution that's come into your life is there because of happenstance or there because of some coincidence. No, it's always purposeful. Nothing can touch my life without going through heaven's filter first. Everything that comes my way is either caused by a sovereign God or allowed by a sovereign God. And you might say, well, wait a minute, doesn't that make God a great big cosmic bully? Doesn't that make God kind of like the kid with that weird obsession with taking a magnifying glass and frying ants? Doesn't that make God that way? No, and here's why. There's always a purpose to the pain God allows in my life. So life does happen to Christians, just like it happens to non-Christians. It rains on the just and the unjust. Another response that people give is not only this shouldn't be happening to me, but many people say this is only happening to me. Let me make a promise to you this morning, which is a bold one. Again, I don't know everybody that watches it, but I've lived long enough to know this. There are people watching this video. They're hearing my voice. They're seeing this bald-headed preacher talk. And here's what I know about them. There are people who are struggling right now. You're watching this video, and you may be worn down. You may be brokenhearted. You may be grief-stricken. You might be troubled. All sorts of people with all sorts of problems are watching this right now. You are not alone in your suffering. We are all facing some kind of battle. Life's a battle, man. Remember, we're followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was one who suffered. Verse 13, Peter addresses that. He says, but rejoice inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. Peter's saying, listen, you're Messiah, you're Lord. He suffered. So when you suffer, rejoice. Rejoice. Jesus sympathizes with us as a fellow sufferer. His life, his early life, was governed by poverty as a poor carpenter's son. He had no place, he set himself, to lay his head. He had fickle friends who would let him down. He was betrayed and abused and rejected by the very people that he had came to save. So if you're suffering, if you're hurting, you're in great company. He's promised never to leave you or forsake you. So you've got to understand that life is an ongoing battle. Secondly, if you're going to bridge that gap between heartbreak and hallelujah, you've got to know to glance at your troubles and to gaze upon your God. Contextually, it's important to note that this letter is written to Christians who are being persecuted, yet they were blessed because of it. In verse 14, Peter writes, "If you're reproached for the name of Christ, happy are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rest upon you. For on their part," speaking of those who are lost, "evil is spoken of, but on your part he is glorified." Put simply, Peter is saying, if you're ridiculed for the name of Christ, you're blessed, because the Spirit of glory and the Spirit of God rest upon you. You say, wait a minute, blessed, happy, it sure doesn't feel that way. I'm suffering, I'm ridiculed, there's lost opportunities, I feel like I've been rejected and I've been despised. Listen, Peter says you're blessed because of the Spirit of glory of God. It rests upon you. This is incredibly important. The language that's used here, when the Bible says, if you're suffering, you're blessed because the glory of God is resting upon you. That word is the Shekinah glory of God. That's the glory of God, the Shekinah glory that rested on the Holy of Holies there in the tabernacle. What does that mean for us? It means, as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, my present circumstances and troubles mean nothing compared to the surpassing knowledge of Jesus Christ. My present problems mean nothing in comparison with the future that I have in Christ. In verse 16, Peter writes, "Yet if any man suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf." Isn't that amazing? Peter is saying when we suffer, there's no shame in suffering. Walking through hardship, there's no shame in hardship. Instead, it's an opportunity to bring glory, honor, and praise to the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Job got that, didn't he? That's why Job was able to say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. That's why Job was able to say, though he slay me, I will trust him. Glance at your problems, but gaze upon the Prince of Peace. By the way, I want to share this before we move on. Peter says something in verse 15 that's magnificent. He said, "But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's affairs." That's speaking of a gossip. You got to be careful. There's a big difference between suffering for his name's sake and just feeling the sting of reaping what we've sown. Peter's saying sometimes you're going to suffer and it's for the glory of God. It's because of your love for the Lord Jesus Christ that you're going to be suffering. It's because you're devoted to him that you will suffer. Sometimes that is the case. But there are oftentimes also where our suffering is self-inflicted. It's self-inflicted. So be careful not to just be a jerk to everybody and say, well, nobody likes me, I guess I'm suffering for the name of the Lord Jesus. No, you're not suffering because you love Jesus. You're suffering because you're a jerk. So there's what Peter is dealing with here in this text. So learn, if you want to bridge that gap between heartbreak and hallelujah, to glance at my problems, but gaze upon my God. Third and finally, if I'm going to bridge that gap, I need to be determined that I'm going to grow because of my suffering. I'm going to grow because of my suffering. Verse 17 is interesting. He says this, Peter says, "For the time is come that judgment begin at the house of God. And if it begin in us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God?" Often when we think about judgment, and rightfully so, we think about separating the wheat from the weeds. But the word that's used here conveys a little different idea. For those in God's household, the household of God that he's speaking of here, the Christian, God is using our suffering to bring me to the end of myself. God is using our suffering to discipline us. God is using our suffering to make us more like the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there's going to come a day where there'll be no more pressure. There'll be no more goodbyes. There'll be no more strife. There'll be no more worries. Someday we'll say so long to this world and hello to God's eternal kingdom. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that a glorious thought? But today, in this life, we're going to struggle. You say, well, how about those who are not in Christ? Will they suffer? Yes. And their suffering will never end. Apart from a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, the suffering that we know will one day come to an end. Revelation 21, no sickness, no crying, no death, no disease. Old things passed away. Behold, all things have been made new. But for those outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ, their suffering will never end. That may be you today. I'm not going to lie to you and say, well, if you'll just get saved today, you can just sing Kumbaya around the campfire, you'll have no more problems. No. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that if you give your life to Jesus Christ, you'll still have problems, but you'll have the grace to face it. Christian, I want to encourage you today, if you're at the end of your rope If you're looking for the light at the end of the tunnel and it's still dark, if you're ready to throw in the towel, don't give up. Know that this life is a battle. You're not walking through something abnormal. It's not strange. These things are happening. Life is an ongoing battle. I want to encourage you to glance at the circumstances that you're around and gaze upon your Savior. I want you determined to grow because of it. I want to close with a story that I heard years ago about a man. I think it was a true story, who was walking home in a blizzard there in Alaska. It was a total whiteout. The wind was howling. The snow was coming down. You couldn't see the hand in front of your face. He just pointed himself in the direction that he assumed was home and started walking. For hours, he trudged along trying to find his house. Eventually, he was on his hands and knees, weary and worn. He was crawling towards his home. Eventually, he couldn't take it anymore. He reached into his pocket and he wrote out a note to his family, how much he loved them and cared for them. And he wrote those words, "I'm sorry I had to stop. I couldn't take it anymore." He went to sleep and he died. Well, as the sun came out a few days later and the snow began to fall, they found this man about 6 feet from his front porch. He quit 6 feet from home. Christian, my great fear is that if you're watching this video and you are trudging along in that snowstorm, maybe you've lost your way. Don't quit. How sad would it be if you quit 6 feet from home? I wonder how close to victory you are. Maybe you're just feet away. Don't quit now. I wonder how close to an answered prayer you are. Don't quit. What if you're just a few feet away? I wonder how close you are right now. Dear friend who's watching this, they don't know if you have a relationship to Jesus, to salvation, to giving your life to him. Don't quit now. Father, your word is good, and you are good. I pray that you would use it in our lives. Help us, Lord, to be more like you. Help us to glorify you in our suffering. Thank you for our time together today in Jesus' name. Amen. Sundays. What is so special about Sundays? Some may answer that question by saying, well, nothing really is special about Sundays at all. It's just another day for me. Others might say, well, Sundays are the last opportunity that I have to kick back and relax a little bit before the work week begins or another hectic school week kicks up. But for Christians, Sundays are special, aren't they? Sundays are a day that we have set aside intentionally to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords corporately. Now, what I mean by that is Sunday is a day that we gather. The body of Christ, a family of faith. We gather together. We assemble together to lift high the name of Jesus in song. On Sundays, we gather together to pray. On Sundays, we gather together to read the scriptures. On Sundays, we gather together to preach and to hear the word of God preached, respond to the word of God. On Sundays, we gather together for fellowship. Sundays are incredibly special. This, of course, has been interrupted by COVID-19 as churches in our community, in our state, our nation, even all over the world, in a good faith effort to stem the tide of COVID-19, to flatten the curve, to love our neighbors well, we have suspended over the last few weeks our Sunday corporate worship services. Well, this has been hard. It's been incredibly difficult. And if you're anything like me, absence has only made the heart grow fonder and you ache more today than when this thing began to gather together with your church family to lift high the name of Jesus. It's because of that that I am so thrilled to announce to you today that after much prayer, after consulting with leaders in the medical community, in the faith community, in government, on a local, state, and federal level, in a spirit of cooperation and unity with the leadership here at Union Baptist Church, that we've got a plan in place that will enable us to begin to gather in this beautiful auditorium once again to worship the Lord corporately. As I've told you from the very beginning of this pandemic, when we gather together again, it's going to look much different. We must remain flexible. I'd also like to remind you that this is a fluid situation. It continues to change, and it will continue to change as the days go on, and we will adjust our plans accordingly. I'd also like to note that as you hear this plan, the temptation might be to say this is a very slow process. It is. Intentionally, it's a very gradual plan that we have put in place because the situation that we're in is a long-term situation, so we must plan accordingly. That being said, we believe that we've crafted a plan that will enable us to begin gathering together again in a manner that's wise and won't pose additional health risk to our congregation or to the community that we love, that we serve, and that we care for. Allow me to very briefly share a simplified version of this plan. And after you listen, I would encourage you to visit unionbaptistiva.com for a more detailed format of what I'm going to share with you today. Our plan is a three-phase plan, with each phase allowing a little bit more liberty than the last. Now, I should note that toward the end of each of these phases, our leadership team will meet and we will make any adjustments that are needed. Now, phase one begins on Sunday, May the 17th. Isn't that exciting? On Sunday, May the 17th, we're going to gather together for worship. Now, that being said, we're going to strive to honor Governor McMaster's recommendations that if we get together again as a church family, we need to continue to maintain social distance. And he's also asked us to operate at a 20% capacity. The only way that we're going to be able to do that because of the size of our church family is to offer multiple worship opportunities. So beginning Sunday, May 17th, we're going to have three opportunities for corporate worship. We're going to have an early service at 9:15. We're going to have a 11 o'clock service, and we're going to have a online service simultaneously at 11 o'clock. During phase one, there will be no Sunday school. Wednesday night activities will be limited to online only. Phase two will begin on Sunday morning, June the 7th. On June the 7th, we'll continue with all three of our worship opportunities: early service at 9:15, an 11 o'clock service, and a 11 o'clock online service. During phase two, Sunday school will resume at 10 a.m. All Sunday school classes will resume, and on Wednesday evenings, we will gather together on church campus once again at 7 p.m. for our adult Bible class, for our youth ministry, for all of our children's ministry programs. This will begin on June 7th. Phase three will begin on Sunday morning, July the 5th. Again, we'll be offering all three worship opportunities: a 9:15 early service, an 11 a.m. service, and an 11 o'clock online service. We'll continue with Sunday school throughout phase three. All of our Wednesday night programming will be in phase three. We'll begin to offer discipleship training courses at 6 p.m. on Sunday evenings, and our choir ministry will resume in July, on July 5th, phase number three. Now, the question obviously becomes, well, how do I know which worship service that I'm going to need to go to? Well, in order to stay within the bounds of our governor's recommendations, we're going to have to be able to really limit service size. We've got to be able to track that. In order to do that effectively, we have already taken the groundwork out of it for you. We have determined by Sunday school which classes are going to go to the 9:15 service, which are going to the 11 a.m. service. If you're not in a Sunday school class, it is determined by alphabetical order. It just depends on what your last name is. Now, That being said, we realize that there are going to be some who are assigned or recommended to a particular service who cannot attend that service for whatever reason. It could be work. It could be that the way things worked out, that you were in one service, but your family was in another service. We don't want that to be the case. So concessions will be made. This is not rigid rules. These are recommendations. These are just recommendations. This plan's not perfect, but it is a plan. And it does allow us the opportunity to start phasing back in. We're really excited about that. So I want to encourage you to visit unionbaptistiva.com to find out kind of where you're going to fall on this thing. Now, let me say this before we log off. During all three of these phases, we want to encourage you, if you are immunocompromised, we want to encourage you to take advantage of our online services or to take advantage of our WCTEL cable television ministry and not risk gathering together and getting sick. We're going to use hygiene practices like we've been doing for some time before the pandemic began. We are going to ask people to wash their hands. We're going to have hand sanitizer stations all over the church. We're not going to do the offering with men passing the offering plates around. They'll be at the back of the church like we did the last time that we gathered together. And all of those other practices, we're just asking our folks to be wise. We're eagerly anticipating phase number one on Sunday, May the 17th, and we can't wait to see you. God bless.